Ladies and gentlemen, good evening and welcome to episode 13 of Brand Studio Live. I'm Rameet Arora and I have a brand new set of brand masters with me in the newsroom today. Hosted jointly by HT Brand Studio and the DMA Asia, Brand Studio Live brings together the country's top CXOs to talk about the hottest topics facing brands and in marketing leadership today. In the process, we not only end up learning from the best, but we're also deeply inspired by the people who come onto this show. Without further delay, let's get started with today's episode. Brands and consumers have never been closer. Depending on the day, that's a great thing, sometimes not. But as consumers, their lives have changed, quite literally. Technology enables convenience, it empowers sections of society that have never had a voice. It enables safer, easier lives, mostly. And now increasingly it impacts culture and our way of life. That's the piece we're going to delve into today with our brand masters. My first guest is Sairi Chahal, founder and CEO of Shiro's. Sairi is India's foremost evangelist for women at work and the convener of Shiro's Summit, India's largest women in business forum. Sairi has been bestowed with the Devi Award winner, apart from the Femina Achievers Award and the Femina Women's Award. Welcome to HT, Sairi.
Thank you so much.
Sairi, let's start with a question which I know is very close to your heart. Is this the decade of internet for women? Are women going to lead the charge both for the economy and for the internet?
I think, look, internet's the most fascinating technological phenomena of our times. And gender gap continues to be one of the largest global challenges facing all of us. It's almost inevitable that women's internet will change the game, not only about how lives of women change all over the world, but also we will discover how internet can be more magical, and it can be more creative, it can be more trustworthy, and it can be more high empathy. And that's something that we are seeing play out thanks to many, many factors, given where we are in India, given where internet is, where the whole gender story playing out. I promise, if you walk into a small village today and you ask a woman who's 35 and a girl who's 13, and you ask them what do they want, basically they want a mobile phone with data on it. And I think that speaks a lot about aspirations of women. The good thing is, women use internet in very, very fascinating ways. So there was a report by Google 3 days ago that said there are four constructs to women, women's internet. One is safety. They're constantly looking for safety and privacy. Second is they're looking for a community. They will always engage in a community. Third is they're looking for content that's differentiated, more knowledgeable, more trustworthy, more factual, or more kind content, if I may say. And then they're looking for use cases. They're looking for a range of use cases ranging from healthcare, to learning, to growing opportunities, to taking their hobby online, to making a business of what they do online. And I think that's changing how the flavor of internet in days to come and decades to come will sort of pan out.
India's always been about communities.
Yes, and India's had a fascinating history of communities doing well. And I think we're one of the few countries where women-only communities have done exceptionally well. We're the only country where microfinance movement was led by women and made successful by women in communities offline. We have Seva here, we have Amul here, we have the Anganwadi network, and we have millions of self-help groups. So this behavior is embedded in India. This is not a new behavior. All some of us are doing is taking this behavior online, and we're saying, hey, you could now do this on a WhatsApp group. You could get together on a platform. You could interact slightly differently. But the behavior is intrinsically finding work, play, and support needs in your go-to community. That community could be an Anganwadi network, it could be a self-help group, it could be a mom group, it could be a kitty group, it could be, and women have always engaged in in groups, because that's their support structure. That's also a space to take away their loneliness. The loneliness of being a woman, the me space has always been missing. And I think a lot of what we will see is going to play out in this format.
Wonderful. Do we have some questions?
Is there something that you think telecom companies could do in order to further women's causes? Because I think just placing a phone in a woman's hands in the context of Seva and Amul and the many other examples that you took could rapidly or
absolutely
radically change lives for women.
I have always dreamt of, and maybe India should do this at a mass level. You know how we've been talking about putting an LPG cylinder in every woman's kitchen? I think we should sort of, as a national agenda, talk about putting a mobile phone in every woman's hand and enable it. There's a whole ecosystem that exists. There's the telco, there is the hardware manufacturer, there's the data provider, there's the finance provider. Just microfinance every phone out there. Make sure every woman has a phone with data on it. I'm telling you, the texture of this country will change. And we will hit some GDP numbers we would have never imagined. And we have a neighbor, China did this. China runs on women. And China enabled women 2 decades ago. And we are seeing those results today. You know, the number of women billionaires in China, the number of women in workforce, everything changed because they cranked up this engine. So I think we need to look at women as a massive, massive engine of growth. And the good thing is India's there. You know, it's not even like a difficult problem to solve at this point in time, because we have access to everything we need to make this happen. It's like a buffet table. We just need to plate this up nicely. And I foresee this happening in the next 2 to 3 years. It's inevitable. It's going to just grab us by the collar and make it happen.
Yeah. It also changes culture in so many ways. In urban India, with mobile families, nuclear families, more women coming into the workforce.
Absolutely.
Convenience and safety
it
become...
It changes lots of things. So it changes things on 4 or 5 fronts. One is, it just changes women and their identity. You know, when you get online, your identity is your own. It's not your husband's, it's not your family's, it's not your father's. Internet gives you identity. Second is access to healthcare. Healthcare data, healthcare advice, reproductive information. It enables that. It enables payments and workforce. You know, we know that as a global economy, we're only going to go in direction of gigs. That's the only thing that's going to grow small and medium businesses and gigs. And women hold that. Every woman makes something. Every woman is a small, medium business owner. Every woman has a hobby that she can convert into a business. And fourth is, what it does is, it enables families to do better, because women have access to better support structures, legal information, parenting information around their own interests, whether it's writing or traveling or cooking or blogging or just sort of, you know, writing poetry. It creates a lot of support system around that. And I guess that's powerful, especially if you sort of zoom down to, let's say, a small village or a small taluka and a small middle-class family, whether it's a joint family or a nuclear family. The dynamics change because suddenly you have access to a satellite network outside of your context. And that's powerful. And we see it playing out every single day.
Thank you so much.
You
that
so
was
much.
Wonderful. What a start to the episode.
Thank you.
My next guest is Amir Jalil, Group CCO and Chairman Mullen Low Linters Group. Amir joined Low Linters in 2002 as Creative Director. He's built brands like Micromax and Havells from scratch. He's conceived and led the journey of Tata Tea's Jagore movement. It's a pleasure to have you.
Thank you.
Amir, you know, this whole marriage between technology and marketing is a happy one or a sad one, like I said, depending on what day it is.
Yeah.
But there's also the consumer in the middle.
Yeah.
And, you know, from where you sit,
that's
the most important piece. Yeah. Tell us a little bit about how the customer fits into this equation and whether technology really works for this person sitting in the middle that everybody is sort of trying to bridge.
It was traditionally my job to unlock the customer for marketing. And now I find that, you know, marketing is unlocking the customer on its own. Yeah. They're reaching the customer, you know, they're doing things that are directly interacting. That's great. It's fantastic. And it's all happening through technology. You know, the whole big subject of today is technology. Marketing has got, you know, kind of married to technology, right? Consumer is getting benefit, right? But marketing is also getting huge benefit, yeah. Right? Business marketing is getting big benefit. So they have gone away on this honeymoon, right? Marketing and technology have gone away on the honeymoon. But they have forgotten, I think, or that they have taken the consumer along on this honeymoon. So any chance they get, they're like, marketing and technology are making out, but the consumer is right there watching, you know, this making out. And sometimes the fellow is getting, or the lady is getting a little irritated, sometimes a little ignored, that what is this thing going on between them? And I want to tell you a few things that I feel as a consumer, like that when I interact with technology, that's related to marketing, right? So first of all, I feel chased. So once upon a time, I looked for a sari for my wife, right? For something. And now saris are chasing me like, they just don't stop chasing me, man. Everywhere I go on any platform, anything like that, it's sari, sari, sari chasing me. Second, you know, I feel that, I feel a bit, you know, exposed and a bit sort of naked. The second I became chairman, I was exposed to the whole world, and through all these data vehicles and everything, people started again targeting me. So financial guys, real estate guys, luxury product guys, everybody was after me. I felt judged, you know, like to the world. I want to be private, man.
Sure.
I want to be a little away. And see, I am there to aid, you know, I'm in advertising, I'm there to aid marketing. So I don't want to make a point against marketing. But I think marketing should realize that there are these things also happening in the world of consumers. The fact that you're feeling chased, the fact that, you know, bots are talking to you, you know, all this is having an effect on consumer culture. And finally, if you're going to be, I mean, that's your most valuable asset, the consumer. And being the person who unlocks the consumer, it's my job to bring it to the attention to the of the world, to the world and to the world of marketing that, you know, this is happening, right?
As so, a creative director, yeah. How does life change? Does it become tougher? Does it become easier? And are you, are creative directors now looking as technology is something they can innovate with, or yeah, as a challenge?
I'm unable to figure out the nuances. So I feel that the more data, the more technology comes into my interaction space, I lose touch with people, right? Because if you tell me a lot of statistical points, data points and all, and I forget that, you know, I interact with people in the metro, you know, in the mall, at home, and with in my office, if I don't keep that up, if I don't keep that human sort of connection on, and if I only sort of focus on how to talk through the data points, I don't think I'll do a very good job, because I don't know how to emotively, you know, make a proposition come alive. So I have that fight on my hands on a daily basis.
Any questions, any reactions?
Is there a way to address through communication, you know, this, you know, this little pain that consumers have today, which is as a result of targeted and personalized communication? I think we have to accept the fact somewhere that the world has changed and we're going to be exposed to that kind of communication more and more. And there are many upsides to it as well. People are getting, they don't have to hunt too much and they really get what they want very quickly. But then there are these smaller or, you know, so to say, downsides as well. Yeah. Is there a way through communication that we address those downsides? Yeah. Is what I'd love to hear from.
See, I think everything boils down to privacy, right? And I know that a lot of people are not in the same space. I may be an evolved sort of consumer, but people are getting there, right? And what they are not liking is the invasion a little bit. I think people like to not be spoken to directly. I don't know, I'm just postulating here. I think if you speak like that, you know, to a lot of people, you know, I think it's better that I feel that, okay, this brand is actually speaking to a lot of people and I happen to be there, you know, within your shot. I think that is something that a lot of marketers and a lot of advertisers should practice. That is the most important thing I feel. But at the same time, I think, interaction with technology is also changing consumers, right? Selfies, taking Instagram photos or various other things. These are new cultural phenomena that is happening in the world that we talk to, right? And I think to notice that cultural phenomena and feedback so that you know, or the consumer knows that you know them well, right? You are empathetic to them. You understand their thing. So just as an example, you know, a few years ago, we had a sort of cell phone brand and we were advertising. And really everybody at that point was saying, what is this new culture? Everybody wants to take their own photos, selfie, selfie, selfie. What is going on, right? And we noticed that trend and we said that actually, you know, it may not exactly be about vanity. It might be just capturing the moment, right? And we created a new sort of brand work for that cell phone brand called Selfistan, right? The world of just documenting yourself, documenting the moments, it's beautiful. So you saw that moment, you addressed it. I think consumers recognize it when you recognize their thinking, their development and things like that. So I think it's really important to keep close like that to their minds.
Wonderful. It's always great to have a contrarian in the group because it gives a reality check. Okay. Thank you so much.
Right. Thank you for
this. Lovely.
Thank you so much. Yes.
My next guest is Vani Gupta Dandia, who's an independent marketing expert. Vani's had a rewarding career of over 20 years, starting with advertising and then various roles in marketing and category management. In her last role with PepsiCo, she was leading the Indian snacks category. Welcome, Vani. Is technology going to play a large role in the way A, women emerge as consumers, and B, marketers reach out to them?
So, let me first start with just why technology into women is just so powerful. I think technology is actually placing technology in the hands of women is placing power in the hands of the world's most powerful, potentially powerful consumers. And if you look at the opportunity, it's a huge opportunity. The second point I want to make is that women just take to technology a lot faster. And isn't that natural? Because women are more time stressed. Women are juggling so many things at the same time that they're looking for aids to make their life easier. And technology helps you do that. The third point I want to make with the context of technology is the fact that most of the technology today is actually crafted for men. There is a beautiful article in The Guardian very recently that talks about how this is actually a world that's entirely made for man. When Siri was first crafted by Apple in the US, Siri could understand questions like, I'm having a heart attack, and Siri could be trusted to organize Viagra or even prostitutes, but Siri couldn't understand if it were told or if she were told, I'm raped. She'd say, sorry, I don't understand what you're saying. You know, if you look at the average size of the mobile phone today, it's 5.5 inches. That size, as per design functionality, is too large for a woman's hands. It's more apt for a man's hands. So in a sense, I think the opportunity in itself is a huge vacant space. There is a lot more that can be done with the opportunity. So I think the opportunity in itself is under-leveraged. Now, in the context of women and marketing, I mean, who would dispute the fact that women shop more and women talk more? Of course, women shop more. But why do women shop more? Why is retail therapy more associated with women? Because women don't just buy for themselves. Women buy for everyone else. Women don't buy only for themselves. They buy for their husbands, their partners, their friends, their kids, their in-laws. Both Facebook and Instagram have more women accounts than they have men accounts. And that's even more staggering considering for Facebook, India is actually the largest market in the world. US is the second largest market. The fact that women talk more, the fact that women share when they're happy, is in itself a huge opportunity. So what does this mean for marketers? As marketers, we owe it to ourselves to just to get to know women better, to be able to understand them better, to be able to serve them better. And how do we do that? To be able to understand that women look for, or women are more connected with brands when there is an emotional connection with brands. Women also value the total shopping experience. For women, it's not a transactional exchange. Women value the fact that a salesman's been nice to me. When a salesman's been nice to me, I wish to oblige by buying not just what I came to buy, but what I didn't come to buy.
And I know there's going to be lots of questions, so we should jump straight to them. Yeah.
Do you see the role of entertainment actually potentially that much more in helping women come online? Hmm. Because I think the first thing that we really need to do is get access to women, get them comfortable with being able to use the technology, and only then the true unlocking of the power. And you spoke beautifully well about various facets through which women can actually use technology, then can happen thereof.
So I think it's a wonderful point you're making. In fact, you know, the thing about entertainment is that that in itself can provide the license for a woman to acquire that little piece of technology, because it feels most innocuous, you know. The truth is that in most patriarchal societies, men are worried about the power that women might acquire with a mobile in her hands. There's a reason why the data packs are designed to be the way they are. So just on the ruse of entertainment, if a woman can have access to technology, and even if it is just that, that in itself can be a huge change agent. Because what it does is it opens up new ways of thinking. Today, even the ability to be able to imagine a reality that's outside of my current reality in itself is a privilege for most of India.
Talking to a woman is getting redefined. I mean, men are really having to watch how they talk. When you start targeting women, right, the way you speak to them in context with the kind of way they were being spoken to earlier, okay, or they were not targeted earlier. So I'm going to give you an example. For example, you know, category like insurance, banking and stuff like that, right? They never really spoke to women earlier. And today they are very clearly speaking to women, right? When you speak to a woman, if you refer to the earlier sort of context, which is, suppose I say that, you know, now that you are being spoken to, how would you take this brand? Now that you have the power in your hands, how would you react to this offering? I find that now that you know, disrespectful, how do you react to that as a woman marketeer? And how would you advise marketeers of brands to talk to women?
I would quite simply say, Amir, we just need more women in marketing. It's disgusting how some of the biggest FMCG companies in this world that have products predominantly for women have all men heading the biggest positions. It's very strange, and I have experienced this enough number of times when we're talking about women users, we're talking about women being the shopkeepers and the shoppers and the gatekeepers, and yet you only have men in the room taking the decision on what women like. Excuse me? You know, women get women better. I mean, isn't that logical? Isn't that natural? I mean, does that take a class to understand that? We simply don't have enough women on the marketing and the advertising side. Because if we did, then we wouldn't have questions like these. We wouldn't have to explain why this piece of communication feels like, oh, now that you're being spoken with. From my own experience, where I have felt in the room, I felt like I've completely frozen up because I'm thinking, how can the script even be presented? And why are we having these kind of reactions to this script? But I mean, I just feel so offended. And it's difficult to explain to a bunch of women, a bunch of men, why I'm feeling so offended. That can only change when we have more women in marketing. And given that the future of marketing is going to be technology driven, we need more women in technology. Actually, the statistics on women in technology are even more abysmal. They're really sad. And this is true of all countries developing and developed.
Superb. That was very, very enriching.
Thank you.
Lots to think about.
Thank you. Yes.
My next guest is Kanika Mittal, Business Head, Twitter India. At Twitter, Kanika leads key verticals such as automobile, tech, OEM, and FMCG. In her previous role, she was Director and Head of Marketing at Reebok. Welcome, Kanika.
Thank you, Ram.
Do you think consumers can enable cultural movements thanks to everything that's happening with technology in their lives now? Is the consumer really in charge of changing his life and impacting culture?
And I think coming from Twitter, I can safely say that today, with the advancement of technology and the way Twitter has been conceived and the role of Twitter today, for sure the consumer has the opportunity to not only participate in key cultural moments that are impacting the society or the country at a large, but also shape culture. And I think this is a unique power that has been given to consumers today, and it's up to us, to the consumers at large, to use it in the right way. For example, Lahu Ka Lagaan, this was a movement that sort of got created on Twitter, it built on Twitter, and then it reached this massive tipping point. And there were so many bold women participating in that movement that it eventually led to legislative and policy change. And now that is a stellar example of how consumers came together and influenced culture and, you know, made something which is taboo into something so talkable, eventually leading to change. You know, other than that, you know, very recently, hashtag say no to war trended on Twitter in a big way. And that was really the public sentiment, the voice of the consumer per se, again trying to shape that huge cultural moment, telling the government of this country that they would rather have peace, that they'd rather find a way to do things the right way rather than get caught up in any sort of frenzy or jingoism. And all of that public sentiment eventually helped to change the tide that the media was taking overall. So I would say, you know, one of the key things, key aspects is the power that is in the hands of the people. If they choose to participate, if they choose to share their opinion, they do have the potential today to be heard and lead to a cultural change. I think Twitter sits at this unique intersection of culture and purpose. And the audience that comes on Twitter is the most leaned-in audience, the most receptive audience. This audience is coming there with a real view. They want to participate. And what happens when you use, you know, Twitter and technology the right way is that you are able to participate in a more real way. And lastly, you know, I thought I'd put, you know, these 3 points out there. One being the fact that consumers have the power to shape culture. Two being the fact that when the audience is more leaned in and receptive, it's so much more real and beautiful and meaningful. And lastly, I think, you know, a key thing to bringing about this culture change is the fact that other than publishers such as yourselves putting content out there, there is a lot of consumer-generated content out there for consumption, which was never the case earlier. So crowd culture or consumer-generated media is this whole powerhouse of content, voice, opinion, through videos, memes, GIFs, etc., which is again shaping public conversation and again shaping culture through technology. So for example, today you read articles that say the Twitterati said so and so, or this is how Twitter went into a meltdown and this is what people feel about it, and that has become news. So what's effectively happening is technology has led to a brand new media vertical, in a manner of speaking, which is fueled by consumers. And then you have an ecosystem of publishers around it, which taps into consumer-generated media and further amplifies it. So it creates like this tipping effect, which is multidimensional, if I may say so.
Any questions?
One of the things that I often think about is the bubble. You know, there's my voice and people who like me and their voice, and it's all the same. You know, it keeps. As a company, have you guys ever thought about the anti bubble? You know, the opposite ML, the negative ML algos that will sort of show you things that are absolutely not similar to your point of view. And I think if there's one platform that can do it, it's Twitter.
Yeah. I think to answer your question, all I can say is it's a one-line answer. Twitter is extremely committed to health and transparency. It is something that has been said in the press by the Twitter management, and it's definitely out there as a commitment very clearly.
When people react in the same positive manner and the same direction as what the brand is expecting, it's great, right? But Twitter is not just about that, right? Twitter is about all kinds of equality everywhere, right? And many people, consumers, don't like everything that a brand is saying, right? How does Twitter react as a brand and not just as a platform when, you know, people react negatively? What happens to Twitter? What does Twitter wonder about?
You know, it really varies from message to message and the relevancy and the topicality of that message at that point in time. So if we take the example of what Nike did with the Kaepernick campaign in the US, it was a very bold campaign. I'm sure a lot of you would have seen it. And when they took it to market, they took it to market knowing that some people will love it and some people will hate it, and that they were strong enough to take the love and hate and still go for it. Ultimately, they did get both love and hate, but they also got a huge lift in their stock value, in their sales, in their brand love, in their brand salience, because they took both love and hate in stride. Point is, I think somewhere brands need to take a stance, and you cannot be true to a purpose without taking a stance. So I think it's a combination of being bold and the choice of being personalized.
Thank you.
Wonderful. That was fantastic. Thank you. It was lovely. Yes.
Thank you.
My next guest is Akash Banerjee, Head Advertising Video on Demand Business at Woot. As part of his current job, Akash brings together the world of brands, technology, and content. Prior to this, he was the head of marketing for Hotstar. Welcome, Akash.
Thank you.
Akash today will tell us how brands can drive higher customer lifetime value, especially in the age of hyper-consumer segmentation world. You know, tell us a little more about that.
Let's just start with some interesting data points about India, this fascinating market. India is a prized possession. It houses close to 350 million odd smartphone consumers, and it's equally home to 3/4 of a billion consumers who are operating in the offline world, right? India is also going to reach very quickly to a billion internet subscriber base, where the mobile broadband user penetration is very quickly going to move to an 800 million number, close to 60% penetration. So we are talking about a really fascinating market, which is India. I think one of the fundamental questions that we have started asking ourselves, and I will try and share a lot of my experiences at Woot with you all, has been about, while all these numbers are great, how are we as a business truly unlocking the value of this market to drive higher consumer lifetime value, to drive higher business value for your platform? And one of the big things that we've also realized is that, what exactly are you measuring? Are you A, measuring vanity metrics like click-throughs, like completion rates and video views? Or are you truly measuring consumer lifetime value? And are you really measuring at an overall mass level? Or are you really measuring that at a segment level, at a consumer level, at an individual cohort level? And four really big mantras that I continue to focus on: A is, we really need to identify niche segments at scale. B, really realize that precision is the new targeting. Third, you have to continuously be in a state of beta. You cannot end up simply taking calls, decision making on the basis of gut, but everything has to happen on the back of data, hard data. And fourth, very clearly, is that retention is the new acquisition. So let's quickly cover one thing at a time. Identification of consumer segments. We have 55 million consumers coming in every month, giving us 10 billion minutes of watch time. And there are multiple segments that we see. We have the catch-up consumers who come in and who actually end up giving us 50 minutes of watch time every day, every viewer. What they end up watching is a lot of long-form content. And the focus for us has been, how do you continue to give them really great, high-quality, long-form content across genres, across languages, at scale? The second one has been about the insatiables, who are constantly seeking something more, something new, and beyond what is already there as a long-form content. And to them, what we started giving them was a whole artillery of content around content, which is short-form content. So a lot of the auditions, a lot of the making-ofs, which is anyway never there, available on TV. How do you start delivering on that at scale? The third big segment are those consumers who are constantly coming to seek something new and different. And to them, what we give is verticals like news, short movies, short series, things that you will never ever find within the digital ecosystem. And the last part, very clearly, is the retention part. I think for long, we've all been only focusing on let's acquire, let's build scale. But in this new age, I think the only golden mantra, the only way, the only silver bullet through which you can really drive higher business value, if you actually start focusing on what is it that will get the consumers to retain and stay on your platform, right?
Any questions, Kai?
Can we empower brands to not necessarily even need to know what their segmentation is? And can the machines and the machine learning that we build use some of this precision to target consumers better? So the brand owner doesn't care whether he's targeting a 3G or a 4G user. All he cares about is his downstream lifetime value metrics, and then your platform goes in and actually optimizes that. Is that something that you guys have looked at?
Look, at the heart of all what I spoke about, the entire complex world of 1,000-plus odd disparate, unique consumer segments that exist on a platform, that certainly can never, ever happen through manual interventions, right? A brand custodian, a business custodian cannot manually start focusing on, okay, what are the various consumer segments that I have on the platform? It has to very clearly emanate from machine learning. It has to very clearly emanate from the world of complex algorithms that you are actually deploying as a huge resource on your platform, because the world very clearly is not about B2C or B2B. It is very clearly about M2C, which is machine to consumer. My only point, my only submission is, it's not just important to look at what are the various segments available, but you also start focusing on what is the value that you're deriving from each of those unique consumer cohorts. Technology is miraculous because it actually helps us to do more with less, ratcheting really our fundamental abilities to a higher level.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
That was wonderful.
Thank you.
Thank you. My next guest is Jose Antonio Cachaza, Managing Director, La Liga India. Jose has been heading La Liga India's operations since January 2017. In 2018, he played a key role in bringing Girona FC to play in Kerala and starting La Liga football schools in more than 15 cities across India. Welcome, Jose. You're actually accelerating culture in some ways. You're not just promoting sports, you're promoting professional sports. You're teaching us to think in a different way as a country. What role does technology play in that, and how do you see your role and the role of technology in building this franchise?
Sports in this chance, football is taking a central position in Indian culture, and Indian sports culture is already the second most watched sport on TV. Technology is important into that. No, it's fundamental. The way you connect with the fan today is absolutely different as it was 5-10 years ago. The passive fan that receives what you're sending is gone, it no longer exists. Now the fan interacts with you. Take our social media numbers. 3 years ago, we have 300,000 followers in Facebook. I don't know why, because we didn't even publish in English. So probably they like the videos, they like the pictures. Today, we have 3.5 million followers. Basically, we started to look in India first, publishing in English. Second, to have India-focused content. And third, although English is our vehicular language, we are already publishing also in Hindi and in Bengali and in other languages. So this is number one. Social media basically gives you a direct connection with the fan. And also it gives you information from the fan, which is critical. Second, I mean, from this season that's just finishing, we are developing in India really a breakthrough agreement with Facebook, on which all our all La Liga matches are broadcast live for free through Facebook.
Interesting. And Facebook is this virtual interface, and people are watching, people are involved, possibly a community is forming. Do you actually see a behavioral change that happens post these large numbers?
Well, yes. I mean, but everything is quite organic. No, it's not. One mistake you cannot make is to think that everything happens in digital. Let's not forget what our product is. Our product is a football match or 10 football match each weekend taking place in Spain. So we have to sell that here. No, traditionally it was done through broadcast and no much more. Today, what technology is gives you new ways, and also the way the fans interact with you, the way the fans consume sports have totally changed. I mean, it's not only watch the live match, which is what makes so unique sports. I mean, if you compare it with what Netflix does or Amazon Prime does, if you want to watch Narcos, you can watch it anytime you want. But football, if you want to watch El Clásico, it happens one day and at what time. So that's still something unique in sports.
Any questions? Yeah.
The sports bodies of the world and La Liga, what are they doing exactly to, you know, actually make not just the passive consumption of sport, but how do you encourage real, like, kids, people, not just professional players? How do you encourage them? Like, for example, in India, there is a huge problem in cities of having space to actually play.
Well, first of all, the ecosystem of Indian football or any Indian sport has to be managed and changed by you. And when I mean by you, I mean your sports authorities, your political, your government authorities. That's the base. Of course, if we can help with the best we can bring, which is our know-how, we are all game for that. I mean, that's the first thing we need to understand. You cannot expect anyone coming from somewhere else trying to solve your sports development, your grassroots problems. Basically, we can't. We don't know you well enough for that. Also, I can say that's a modest program of football schools, bring kids to play. We launched it at the beginning of this season, last September, and we have already 30, more than 30 centers in 14 metro areas. Being is both in school or after schools, but we have almost 4,000 kids training with us. And what's important for the development of any sports that you have to have thousands, tens of thousands of boys and girls playing. I'm playing primarily for fun, because probably just 1% of those will be good enough for thinking into going to high competition.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Wonderful. My next guest is Gautam Shivakramani, Advisor International Growth at Kora. Prior to Kora, he was the founder and CEO of Audio Compass, a company focused on enhancing travel experiences with location awareness and do-it-yourself guided audio tours. It's a pleasure to have you, Gautam.
Thanks.
How does knowledge actually become the point at which you're empowering customers? And how is Kora helping customers to stay ahead with knowledge? Or is it information, actually?
First of for us, the way we think about it is knowledge is power, and knowledge has the ability to change lives. So the best type of empowerment that you can give to a consumer is to actually empower them with knowledge that is permanent and lasts forever. And that's really what we focus on as a company and as a brand. And we've seen sort of organic use cases of this get started, from consumers talking to other consumers about their experience using a product or a brand or evaluating a product or a brand, to companies themselves now becoming part of the narrative and, you know, answering questions that are best answered by the brand themselves. And these, again, are not individual one-off questions like, can you please reset my billing cycle? But, you know, larger questions that are relevant to the whole community and to the entire or a large subset of the brand. To also now, of course, we've got an ads offering as well where brands are now answering questions and then promoting those or having their message shown alongside other content and other Q&A on the platform. We think that there are four core principles that any platform that looks to share knowledge or empower consumers with knowledge needs to imbibe. And those four principles can be through product features and product levels and values and principles. So one of them is trust and safety. For us, we are an open platform, but we have very, very strong standards as a community. Very often that upset some of our users around, Quora being a place for civil discourse, for respectful conversation. So all points of view are welcome, but we don't tolerate hate speech. We don't tolerate trolling. We take it, we act proactively monitor this to take it down, as well as use a bunch of machine learning and consumer reporting to take down, content that is sort of doesn't advocate trust and safety and doesn't contribute to trust and safety. The second aspect to it is quality and credibility. As a platform, of course, where it's impossible for us to go out and verify every single piece of content that's on the platform. So we make sure and we use product levers to make sure that we are able to detect the quality and credibility of content on the platform, and that our consumers and our users are able to also determine for themselves how credible content is. The third and fourth ones, very quickly, one of them is permanence. So again, for a knowledge sharing platform, you don't want the same knowledge being shared over and over again. So we've invested a lot in making sure that content on Quora is evergreen. You don't want people answering the same questions over and over again. So we've invested heavily in making sure that the knowledge on that multiple questions that effectively have the same answer get merged, those kind of like very tactical things as well. And finally, the last thing which we've talked about a lot, so I won't spend too much time on it, is personalization. You want to make sure that what is knowledge for me might be different than knowledge for you, because we have different perspectives. So how do you as a platform make sure that you're able to deliver the most useful and relevant knowledge to an individual? And we have a community product that supports that called Quora Spaces, as well as our own personalization sort of algorithms that support that as well.
Wonderful. Questions?
You talked about, Quora being a platform that does not tolerate hateful content or anything that's disrespectful. How does technology play a role in making sure that you have content that's meaningful, that answers the question, that also entertains dissent because people have different points of view, but at the same time does not feel disrespectful?
Yeah. So I think this is something that we've done really well. We started working on this very, very early on. Obviously, it's not humanly possible given our scale. We have 300 million monthly unique visitors, 70 million in India, to actually monitor every single piece of content that goes on the platform. So what we do is we use a combination of machine learning, proactive moderation, and so that's proactive, review, and our community. So we've established the norms of our community, and now that we've hit the scale that we've hit, it's understood that when you join Quora, you can voice your dissent, you can voice your point of view, but if you're not respectful, not only will your content get taken down, but for repeat bad actors, we actually even go as far as banning users from the platform. And again, we think that that is a small price to pay towards achieving our long-term mission of unlocking the knowledge in people's heads and putting it on the internet. Yeah.
Wonderful. Thank you so much, Gautam.
Thanks.
My next guest is Snehil Gautam, Group Head of Marketing and Growth at Housing.com. Snehil has many years of experience in marketing, customer growth, analytics. Prior to Housing.com, he's worked with ICICI Bank and other BFSI companies in various roles. But talk to us a little bit from the point of view of a marketer of how, you know, relevance and how English speaking not becoming the inhibitor to accessing the internet and accessing products is going to impact the world and brands.
This topic has been around, lots of people have been discussing on different forums that how will we target next section of people who are beyond 200 million plus internet users. Google, you know, gave a very good solution to that in terms of three V's, which is vernacular, video, and voice. So I'm going to talk about it in more detail. Let's recap what has happened in India in the last few years. Jio happened. It has taken internet active users to another sphere now. Our data consumption is 8 GB per subscriber per month, which is equivalent to any developed country in the world. Our data is the cheapest in the world right now. Smartphone prices has decreased significantly, which means that internet is now available to much more users than it used to be. As a marketeer, we need to understand that the needs of these customer base is very different from first 100 or 200 million internet users. They want to do commerce, they want to communicate, they want to consume content in non-English languages. And preferably, if they don't have to type, if they can just push the button and get the things done, they will be more than happy to do that. So as a marketeer, our role is to figure out how do we do that? How do we do from the technology perspective? I think at Housing, what we have figured out is vernacular works really, really well for us, especially in non-metro cities. We have done lots of experimentations, and I'm really happy to share some of the results which we have done. We were facing lots of challenges in terms of user acquisition on different platforms, especially Facebook, because that's one of the highest spends channel for us. And then we started vernacular ads on Facebook. You won't believe the client engagement on those ads. We are double of what an English ad has. So click-through rates of vernacular ads, they were twice of click-through rates of English ad. The only problem was we were landing the user on English pages. So the conversion was abysmal. Then we figured out that if CTRs are high, that means you are getting double the traffic for the same amount of spends. The second experiment which we did was we changed the landing page. We made it in vernacular languages. And even the conversion rate was much better than the English page conversion rate. So there is a huge opportunity in terms of vernacular, which we are still not figuring out. 95% of video consumption happens in non-English languages today in India. And video, in fact, has as vernacular, it has extremely good user engagement as far as if you compare that with static ads. So video, we are investing a lot. Lastly, I think voice, the new internet generation who are joining this internet tsunami, they will skip text searches. They will directly move to voice searches because typing right now on mobile in non-English languages, it's extremely difficult. So all these three combined, I think we have really, really big opportunity at our hands. And technology will have to play a big part in enabling that ecosystem for us.
Lots of questions, I can see.
Sure.
I think it's very, very well recognized that there is a huge opportunity to leverage voice vernacular.
Right.
But while there are a lot of takers for it,
a lot of companies require and recognize that you know, being able to leverage voice and vernacular can open up huge new markets for me. There aren't enough creators. There aren't enough agencies. When one actually searches for creators of content, I think we are either still wanting or maybe we haven't been able to discover the right creators. Do you think there is something that, companies can do in order to fuel that creation? I mean, much of it will, of course, come from the increased demand. But what do we also do to actually fuel the supply end of it?
Sure. So I think technology will play a major role in this. In fact, there are companies in India who is doing it at a very large scale, especially, if I can name a few of the brands. ShareChat is doing it really well. Vocal in Bangalore is doing it amazingly. So they are creating lots of content now in vernacular because they understand. See, I think the approach of the organization needs to change. Right now, the approach is English first. In India, you will have to change that approach to non-English first. So that whole approach needs to be changed, and it will start from, the CEO of the company who will have to make sure that whenever a product is being released, it's being released in not only English, but also non-English languages.
On that note, ladies and gentlemen, thank you for joining us on episode number 13 of Brand Studio Live, co-hosted by the HT Brand Studio and DMA Asia. A very special thank you to DMA Asia and Vatsal Asher for helping us. Also, thank you to Fever FM, who's our radio partner and who helps us evangelize this concept. We look forward to another episode. Thank you for tuning in, and do stay tuned in for the next episode, which will come very, very soon. Thank you very much.